Hey guys, this is Zero back with another vlog review. This time we're going to be talking about Power Rangers Dino Charge and Dino Supercharge. Yeah, I know I'm late to the party on this one, but I haven't had as much time to do these kind of videos, so I got some time, so I figured I'd talk about it right now. So, Power Rangers Dino Charge and Dino Supercharge. I thought it was a really good season. There are a couple quirks that I'll talk about, but overall it was a pretty good season. I thought the storyline was very good. I thought the fact that they've had original villains was good. Kind of sucks that they were doing aliens again, but, I still think they did a good job with it. So let me get started off with. So the series starts off basically, with them finding the, Dino Chargers or the Dino Gems, or Energems, I guess you could say, cause these are different from the Dino Gems from Dino Thunder. There might be some comparisons or confusion with Dino Thunder and other seasons, but I'll try to keep it as consistent as I can. We're introduced to our main five Rangers, and then it expands on because, for those of you who don't know, the Sentai for this one was, Kyoryuger. And if you remember a few years ago, I did a vlog review on Kyoryuger as well, and, I really liked it. Now, the thing that I want to start off with is this show is very different from Kyoryuger. Very different. While Kyoryuger had the Samba and Bravery thing going on, and they do mention things in this season, like about you know, they kept It's About to Get Wild as the you know, hype before battle theme, but Kyoryuger couldn't be more different than Dino Chargers. I'm glad about it because there was Samurai, which was very much like the Sentai, but they didn't have a lot of time. And then there was Megaforce, which added a lot of Sentai elements that really didn't need to be there. So, but let's just get into the nitty gritty. So let's start by talking about the characters. So we've got, our Red Ranger, and now I forget his name. Sorry about that abrupt cut. Tyler is his name. I don't know why I forgot that. So Tyler as a Red Ranger, he's, He wasn't, he was kind of bland, but not nearly as bland as other Red Rangers. He was very excitable. His whole point of the first, season was to, and some of the second season was to try and find his dad. His dad was a, dinosaur, officiate, somebody who goes on adventures. So, he wanted to try and find out what happened to him and see if he could find him because he disappeared years ago. So that was a main storyline for that, for him. He also had a relationship going on with the Pink Ranger, Shelby, which we'll get to in a moment. But, yeah, they had some of a relationship going on. And it really grew throughout the series, but it wasn't like, it wasn't nearly as, built up as, say, like, something from the old days, like, Kimberly and Tommy, so, you get what you get with these shows at this point. So, one thing I will mention as well is, because of the reduced budget of this season compared to Super Mega Force, which was an anniversary season, they couldn't do any anniversary episodes. Judd Lynn even set out at a convention when somebody asked if they'd be using the footage from the Kyoryuger versus Go Buster movie, any of that for an episode. He basically said that, well, they had a really expensive last season, so he wouldn't be able to do that, which is kind of a bummer, because we got the shitty reunion and because of the money spent on that, they didn't get anything for this season. But I hear that with Ninja Steel, they're going to be doing something special. So we'll see. I'll get my thoughts on Ninja Steel at the very end of this. So that's Tyler. So we've also got Chase, who was our Black Ranger and the one who was the New Zealander in this series, because, just like Xander, we had to have at least one New Zealand. If we're going to have these, so many people hiding their accents, we should have somebody not hide their accents. Speaking of Xander, Chase is a lot like Xander in a lot of ways, where he's, Chase is full of himself. He thinks he's great. He's obsessed with trying to find a girlfriend throughout the series. And he actually does at one point, and he has to learn, like, that he needs to not talk so much about himself. Where Xander was more suave and, basically just wanted to get out of doing work and stuff, but he still like was kind of trying to be a ladies' man. But Chase was more kind of like that. They really played up the fact that he was from New Zealand in this show. It's like, yes, we know the show is filmed in New Zealand. Let's go to New Zealand, where we are already. That's the thing that's really hilarious about it. They were already there, but let's go there anyways. It's hilarious. So there's not really much more to say about Chase. He has a couple of good episodes, and at first he was kind of going for Shelby, but she wasn't interested, so he stopped pursuing that. So, speaking of Shelby, that's our Pink Ranger, and the thing that was that everybody blew up about when the series came out is that they had a we had a black woman, the first time a black woman's been a Pink Ranger. I'm pretty sure that's the first time that's happened, but I'm not 100% sure. I'd have to go back and check my information. But Shelby's just as much more of a character than that. So, she's technically the youngest one on the team, and she's trying to study become a paleontologist. The problem is she is being basically shoved aside by her peers. In the first part of the series, Kendall treats her very coldly, like as if she sees her some kind of competition, which I thought was getting kind of ridiculous at points when they would just like. Not like it was even getting to the points where the other Rangers wouldn't believe in Shelby. Like, it's like they would never give her a chance. It's stupid, like, why they treated her like that. You know, somebody stood up. I felt like somebody should have just stood up. Somebody, so, Kendall, why you dick to just this one person? Why you gotta be a dick? You got any reasoning for that, or are you just being a dick? You're just being okay. You just being a dick. Okay, gotcha. So, I felt really bad for Shelby at the start because she was basically. Didn't really get a chance to shine for a good chance of the se a good part of the series until she finally showed off her skills. People saw that she was useful, but I love that it was only after they thought she was useful that they started, you know, becoming more friendly towards her. It's like she was already a nice person. Yeah, she was kind of annoying in some instances, but I mean, that's nothing to just like hate on someone for. So, she also, her relationship with Tyler also built up mostly towards the end of the series, but I thought that she was a pretty good character too. One of my favorite Rangers, but my favorite Ranger of the season is the next one we're going to talk about, Coda, the Blue Ranger. Coda was a caveman, and I thought it was genius how they did this, that he had found his Energem back in the caveman days, and then he got, I think it was frozen in ice. I thought that was kind of a cool idea that he was not one of the Rangers. He had most of the funny bits. I felt like for the most part he was comic relief. The season really didn't have comic relief. They didn't have like a Bulk or Skull-esque character. But I thought that for the more funnier moments was Coda trying to figure out like what how things worked in this world or certain things. Like, there's this one scene where he like they're working at the burger place. By the way, all the Rangers work at this burger fast food place inside the museum. And there's one point where he hit a burger in his mouth, and me and my buddy on Unreal go over this all the time. He goes like this, and then he goes, Pah! And then he just spits the burger out and it hits everybody in the face. The actor Yoshi Sadarso, I'm not even gonna try to pronounce that last name. I'm just Yoshi. Most people know him as Yoshi. He's actually a huge Super Sentai and Tokusatsu fan. So he was getting the cast of the show into what they're going to be looking at. I think he would show the episodes of Kyoryuger to the cast. They would recreate scenes. The director, I think directors or writer of Kyoryuger came to the set of Dino Charge, and he did his own Kyoryu change for him. And the funny thing is, Coda actually shows up in Ninja Steel, and his brother is playing the Blue Ninja Steel Ranger, so that's going to be interesting. He's like got like a cameo part. I'm interested to see if they get someone else to voice him for that episode, because that would be hilarious. Because all he does is he's just like a civilian, so. But that's cool. But yeah, Coda was my favorite character mostly because he was kind of the pure-hearted one, and he didn't really know what was going on, but whenever you needed comedy, he was there. There's an episode, a really good episode early on about Riley, which we'll get into next, actually. Good transition. Where all the Rangers were in a room that was freezing over. And Coda's whole thing is he was trying to get a cookie from a vending machine. And every time they cut back to him, it would be about his trials of getting the cookie. And then he finally gets the cookie, and they're like, come on, we gotta go. So he never gets his dang cookie. So that's Coda. He was one of my favorites. Now on to Riley. Riley was another character that I actually really liked. Not just because he was the Green Ranger and his dinosaur was Raptor. Though, I mean, those two things pretty much helped. He was kind of basically, he started off basically being in a world where he didn't belong. He was a farmer, essentially. He helped his brother run the farm or the ranch that they had, whatever it was. And that really was never his calling. Riley's also is the one that tends to be the more clever one of the team. He usually figures things out, like monster strategies and stuff like that. There's a few really good episodes with him. I mentioned the one in the, where the Rangers are trapped in the frozen building or whatever, where he has to outsmart a monster at a puzzle game in order to win. There's a lot of parts in the season where he's figuring stuff out like that. He's kind of an intellectual. I think at one point he helps, Kendall with, developing some, Ranger stuff too, I believe. I'm not 100% sure on that, but, he had a really good arc. I think there was a really good, episode. There's a good episode about him too, about a bully from high school, who has continued to bully him and then finds out that he's actually not terrible. And that episode is difficult because Riley wants to use his Ranger enhancements to help him win a fight. This season doesn't have civilian powers, and we haven't really had civilian powers since I think the last time we had civilian powers was did we have civilian powers in RPM? I think the last time we technically had civilian powers was Overdrive. But the Rangers are a little more powered up because of their energems, so they can do things a normal human wouldn't be able to do, like jump high or run super fast. And at one point, Riley was going to get into a race against this guy, and he's like, oh, well, I'll just use my energem powers. Well, the thought for that is like, he comes to realize, no, that's not fair. I should beat him on my own terms, sort of thing. And Riley, it's funny because the bully, fun of Riley for being bad at PE, but to be honest, I look at Riley, he looks physically fit. I don't see where this is coming from. So, bullies gotta be bullies though. It's a TV show, so they're written bad. So, but anyways, it's, he's a really well-written character, and he's probably one of my other favorites as well. So, and now let's talk about Kendall. Kendall is basically the Zordon of the series. She's the head of the museum. She is their mentor for a part of it. And she is also in control of the command center. She builds the Zords. Well, not builds the Zords, but sort of. It's hard to say. She designed the Dino Charger powers, like using the Dino Chargers over using just the Energebs. So she's basically the Zordon in the series, and she does eventually become the Purple Ranger, which is good because, they were able to use a lot of the footage of, Kyoryu Violet for her and stuff like that. But there is a problem with her character, and I'll get to this when I start talking about other characters. Again, I thought she was a dick in the first part of the series for no good reason. Like, I don't understand why she was a dick. Was she jealous of Shelby? I don't know how. She's a fucking scientist, and Shelby's like a college student, so I don't understand how she would be jealous of that. But Kendall does eventually just warm up to it and not be a dick. So there's that. I guess she was being a dick because she had trust issues, but I'm going to be honest, like, there's no real reason for that. So I don't know. So let's get on to Sir Ivan, who was our Gold Ranger. I like that they did this because, in Kyoryuger, they had, a samurai who was basically trapped within, one of the villains, and from years ago, and that's why, and that's who he was. But Sir Ivy was kind of the same idea, but instead of being like a samurai, he was like a knight of Xandar. Xandar was their Xandar Thunder, the way to work that in, I guess. It was the kingdom that was part of this series, and there's another character who's a ranger who's part of it. He was a knight who was absorbed way back in the medieval times, and for a while, Tyler thought the person trapped inside of Fury was his father. And it turned out to be Sir Ivan. And I like what they did with it because he also had to do the same thing as Coda, where he had to kind of learn how things worked in this time period. But the difference here was is that he already had like chivalry and all these things, so he was a little more cultured, sorry, a lot more cultured than Coda was. But he still didn't understand things. He had some really good episodes. I thought he was a really good character, but there's not really much more I can say about him. Speaking of Xandar, we have Prince Philip III. He is the Prince of Xandar, the current Prince of Xandar. So I'm going to start off by saying, with Prince Philip and on, the next few characters are not in the show for very much. That's mostly because the Sentai footage only you most of these guys are the Spirit Rangers, and the Sentai footage only had so much footage of them. Because being Spirit Rangers, they would only show up when they were absolutely needed. Kudos to the production for putting these guys in more than they should have. Though I will say that there wasn't really much for these characters to do. Prince Philip is the first one. He discovers he's the Graphite Ranger, and he ends up getting the Graphite Energem. And I think that he doesn't really do much. There's not much to say. He's basically, at the start of the show, he's greedy, and then he tries to be charitable, but he doesn't understand what that means. And he's just kind of a odd character, so not much to say. We got James, who is our Aqua Ranger. This is Tyler's dad. He showed up in Dino Supercharge when Tyler was going, it was in Berserk mode. And helped him get out of it. The interesting thing about James is that through him we learn things about how the the energems work, where you don't age. Once you have an energem, you stop aging. So you basically, like, obviously he's still getting older, but looks about the same age as Tyler. And that was, I guess, their excuse for trying to get a young actor to play Tyler's dad. Again, he doesn't do much because he's one of the Spirit Rangers from Kyoryugers for his footage, so there's not a lot with him. The other one I'll mention is there's Albert Smith, who's the original Purple Ranger in the show. He only showed up for an episode or two, so I don't really count him as a full ranger. And he passed his powers on to Kendall, so there's not really much to go off of with him. But he was an interesting character for when he was there. And then there's Zeno Wing, who is the Silver Ranger. And I just, for this one, I'm not sure. Because Zeno Wing is Taurine from Kyoryuger, and I like that they brought the suit back, but at this point there were so many characters, like so many main characters, they didn't really have anything for him to do. He's just kind of there. It's didn't really learn anything about his character. He's there. Oh, excuse me. Again, a lot of these, because there were so many characters and so little Sentai footage of some of them, they really couldn't do much with these characters. So, props to the series for doing what they could, but yeah, nothing really there. So we also got to talk about Keeper, who was really the mystical part of the series. He was the one who had the Energems and passed them on to dinosaurs way, way back when the show started off and he crash landed. into Earth to keep them away from Sledge and the other villains. So let's talk about the villains real quick. So we've had Sledge, who basically was the head of the of his little department there. They were the let's see, how's the best way to describe this? They were kind of like a traveling conqueror, kind of like Grum from SPD. And he had his own set of, he had his own packet of meteors, which were used to wipe out the dinosaurs in the past, because he'd been waiting 10 million years or whatever billion years after dinosaurs to come back and get the energems back again. He waited that long. I don't know why, but we'll get to that in a bit. So I thought Sledge was an interesting villain that they created, but it's funny because I actually bought a mask from a Halloween store that looks a lot like his helmet. So I don't know if they modeled it after that or what, but maybe I'll have a Sledge cosplay sometime in the future. But anyways, I thought Sledge was a decent character. He was an Power Rangers exclusive villain. And I thought he looked kind of cool, but really, I never felt threatened. I thought he was just kind of lame for a lot of the time. He was just like, bring me the energems! The more interesting characters were his lackeys, like Fury, Snide. We'll get to Snide soon. Fury, Wrench, Passandra, which ended up being Sledge's wife or fiance. And then there were like weird characters. Fury had most of the time, because he had the whole thing with the Gold Ranger, but pretty much after that, he wasn't, that big of a deal. And then there was, Singe, which honestly I thought was kind of wasted. There's not even much to say. And then there was, of course, Doomwing, who showed up with Lord Arcanon, which they introduced Arcanon in the second season as being Sledge's boss, and then he was never seen again, and he never interacted with Sledge, so I don't know why he was there. So, talk about Snide and Heckle, the main villains for the second half of the series, for the second season. Snide was the upgraded suit for Zeltrax, and that first bugged me, but I got used to it being its own character eventually. Just another product of them not being able to use the footage. It'd be like if they kept the upgraded Goldar and put him in there somewhere. That wouldn't have worked. But I guess they felt that people didn't really know, Zeltrax that well, or it had been so many years since Dino Thunder happened that they could get away with it. Dino Thunder is my favorite season, so I noticed, but I know that there were a lot of people just don't care. I thought Snide was all right, but he's just kind of like, he was just basically like Sledge Light. He was just like gravelly and evil and yeah. The interesting part of, Snide was Heckle. Heckle and Snide had kind of a Jekyll and Hyde relationship. I guess that's where they got the name Heckle. And he was like a humanoid character, who was from another planet, whose planet was destroyed. So he became a villain. I don't understand that storyline, but, he was conniving. He actually found his way into the Rangers base. He did a lot of things, and, spoiler alert, he eventually does switch sides and sort of, I'm not sure when he gets split off from Snide. But there's a lot of missed opportunity there with him. One thing that I will talk about that really kind of ticked me off, and I understand why they didn't do it, because it's expensive for these kind of shows. I thought Heckle should have become the Power Rangers equivalent of Death Uger. They did the episode with the Spinozord. And I know Death Uger was only really in a movie and made a brief cameo in another one of the movies, but I just or a V Cinema, which basically is like a movie, or direct to video thing. Anyways, Death Eater was my favorite Kyoryuger, and I kind of really wanted to see it in the new season. And I think they were playing around with the idea of doing Death Eater as a full ranger, but they never honestly did that. And I thought it would have been cool if they gave the suit to Heckle. Like, I mean, I understand the show's on a budget, and they already have a lot of Non-Sentai footage, but if you guys are going to shoot Non-Sentai footage anyways, why don't you include one of the Rangers? That's another toy that could be sold. That's, like, it just, I would love a Death Eater figure. I would love one. But from what I understand, they don't exist, or maybe there is an SH figure art, but, like, I would love a Death Eater figure, and if they made, like, a Spino Ranger version in Dino Charge, that would have been great. I could have gotten one of the 6-inch figures or whatever, or 4-inch figures or whatever the line is, but they didn't do that. They didn't even show, I don't think they even showed them that Ranger, but because they were doing the whole thing with the Dark Energem thing, and I thought, well, maybe the Dark Energem, when sent to Heckle, will be good, and then he'll become the Power Ranger equivalent of Death Eater. I thought it was really cool, and I was really hyped about it, but it ended up going nowhere, and that leads me into my feelings on the season. The story for the started out strong. Like, it was, it started out, with introducing us to our characters, the powers, the villains, all of that. And, but with most series that, of these Power Ranger seasons, when it, by the time it gets to the second season, the supercharge or the super season, in this case, supercharge, kind of just kind of peters out. I didn't necessarily drop Power Rangers Dino Charge, but I stopped watching every week, mostly because I had other things to do, but I just, they kind of just, after a point, just felt like it was just kind of keep going for, just for the sake of going. So, there's been this problem that I felt since the Neo Saban era, where there's like, they want to do things, but then they don't do them. So, like the whole Death Eater thing, for example. I really thought that's where they were going, and then they backpedaled and changed, I guess, decided they weren't going to do it. It's like, they have these great ideas, but they don't have the money to do them, so they think that they can do them at the time, and then they backpedal. There's also kind of like a weird, it's a weird time. It feels like Power Rangers is being made for younger and younger children, and while this is, I am not the target demographic for this show, I'm an adult, you can tell they were listening to the fans on this season, because this season is, like, much improved over previous Neo Saban seasons. Like, this was basically their last chance, in my opinion, to do something right with the Power Rangers franchise, or I was going to be done with the franchise again. And they, you know, they did it. They knocked it out of the park. So, kudos to them. But it honestly still, like, I love the season. And at the start, I really was liking it. I thought this is going to be really good. And in the end, it did end up being really good. But there's parts of it that just, I just still felt like it could have been better. It could have been much improved. And it still felt like it had that Neo Saban feeling where it's, you know, being made for smaller children. Some of the acting is mixed. The main cast, the acting is great, but some of the other characters, the acting is really mixed. And some episodes just were kind of, eh, I didn't really care for them. So it's, as time went on, I started like, when it got to the second season, Dino Supercharged, I started being less interested in the episodes. I'd have my phone on me during watching some of the episodes. That's how much I cared for some of these storylines. So, and that's not a good way to have your show. You want it to be engaging, which I will say, as much as I'm giving this show crap, I think they did a good job. And I thought the last, couple episodes, that ended off the series were good up until the very last scene. And everybody's talking about this. So they did the whole time travel thing. They sent, it was sad because they sent Coda and Ivan back in time to their regular times. And then they come back to their time. And spoiler alert, dinosaurs are still alive. Which means this season is not in canon with the main series. Which is good and bad. It's bad because now if they ever want to have a crossover or have Dino Charge characters show up, it's going to be kind of awkward, kind of like it is with RPM. It's good because it doesn't have to fit into what the continuity has. Sorry about that. My camera shut off. It happens sometimes. I knew this was getting long, so I'll try to make this rest of this brief. I don't like the fact that the series isn't canon. I know it's, in my opinion, it's just a bad thing for it to not be part of the canon series. And they could have easily just cut that out. They could have easily just not brought that up. Because I understand why they did it, because they said that Sledge was the reason that the dinosaurs were wiped out because of meteors. But you could have easily fixed that and be like, wait, why are there no dinosaurs? We defeated Sledge. Oh, the Ice Age happened. That's it. Like, that's all they could have done. That's what all they had to have done. Because I don't think it's really been proven how the dinosaurs died. I could be wrong. I'm not a scientist or anything like that, so I have no idea. But I think the main theories are meteors and Ice Age. And you could have just gotten away with saying, oh, the Ice Age killed them, actually. The meteors didn't actually kill them. It must have been the Ice Age. That would have been better than dinosaurs are alive again. How do you tame a T-Rex? How do you tame a Brontosaurus? Like, I know there are animals in the world that are vicious, but they're not animals that are skyscraper height. Like, this makes no sense. And it's just an excuse for them to add some more bad CG. So I was very mixed on the series once I saw that ending. I thought the final episode was great until it got to that point. It's like, I don't know. I thought it was kind of ballsy, I guess, for them to do, but it wasn't good. So, to basically sum up my thoughts on the series, it was, in my opinion, it was improvement. The last four seasons before this, which were actually two, Samurai gets kind of a pass because they didn't have a lot of time to work on things. Megaforce and Super Megaforce, while I liked Megaforce, Super Megaforce ruined it for me and just shat on the franchise. This was good because it was revitalized. And this was, again, in my mind, the last chance for Power Rangers to keep me watching. Because after this point, if it had been the same old shit, I would have been just like, well, there's no reason for me to go keep watching this. This obviously doesn't interest me the way it did before. So I'm not going to bother. But to my surprise, it ended up being a pretty good season. And I mean, I wasn't super surprised. They had Judd Lynn in control of it. So whatever. And that leads me into just a little segment. I'll say that I've seen the first two episodes of Ninja Steel. I've watched the premiere. I like what I see so far. And I'm hoping this season will be just as good, if not better, than Dino Supercharge, or Dino Charge, I should say, the entirety of Dino Charge. Now, the thing to remember with this, too, is, as you probably noticed on my channel, there is no Ninja review. That's because I dropped Ninja. After 20-ish episodes, I was done, and I gave up. A lot of people didn't like Ninja, and it's hilarious, because when I dropped it is when some really good episodes apparently came out afterwards, but I just, at that point, I was done. So I actually only know up to a certain point of what the Sentai did. I've seen, obviously, some rumors and other stuff and sub-spoilers because I didn't care. But this is going to be the first time in a long time that I've gone to a Power Ranger season without knowing anything about the Sentai. Well, no, something, but not nearly as much. And I think that's exciting. And I can't wait to see what they do with it, because Ninja was terrible. So they can only go up from here, in my opinion. But yeah, I am very excited for what the future holds. And Dino Charge did a good job of keeping me interested as a Rangers fan. So anyways, guys, I'm sorry for the long-winded review. I will see you next time when we talk about Ninja Steel in a couple years. It'll probably be 2019 by the time I get to that review, but I will see you guys then, and I hope you have a good one. Don't forget to leave your comments down below on what you thought of Dino Charge and Dino Supercharge. Smash that motherfucking like button, and subscribe if you're new here for more content like this. Thanks for watching. See you next time.